वेलकम टू डॉक्टर जीपी शर्मा सर. आई वुड लाइक टू वेलकम डॉक्टर जीपी शर्मा सर आवर स्पीकर फॉर टुडेज ओकेजन्स. रिस्पेक्टेड डीन सर, माय कलीग एंड ऑल स्टाफ मेंबर्स एंड डियर स्टूडेंट्स, today we are going to start interesting webinar on application of microwave in food processing. In food processing, there is a everyone and every home a microwave heating has vast application in the field of food processing. Over a period of several decades, the application of microwave heating in processing, including drying, pasteurization, sterilization, tempering, bank of food material. Today's microwave or has home become one of most popular home application for the food processing and applications to consumers have a widely applications. The microwave technology, due to a wide range of advantages in microwave, the technology is emerged as one of the most promising food processing and technology. This has been properly due to these considerable advantages over conventional heating method. The improvement include a high heating rate, lower processing time, more uniform heating, safe handling, easy to operating, low maintenance, and energy efficiency. There is a best and economical to advantage and structure for food processing and application. I would like to introduce our today's emerging speaker, Dr. G.P. Sharma, sir. So, Dr. G.P. Sharma, sir, currently working as a professor of food engineering at Maharana Pratap University of Agriculture and Technology, Udaipur. He obtained his B.Tech in Agriculture Engineering in 1982 from University of Udaipur. He did his M.Tech and PhD from IIT Kharagpur in 1984 and 2001. Dr. Sharma has more than 30 years experience and has responsible position in the such as a chairman, placement cell, academic coordinator, nodal officer and controller of examination of university. Dr. Sharma sir actually engaged in teaching UP and PG as well as PhD student. His guidance several PG and PhD student he published 68 research paper in national and national. He has participated and also organized several national seminars. Dr. Sharma has been awarded a Best Teacher Award in 2015. Distinguished Service Award by Indian Society of Agricultural Engineers, New Delhi. And Best Paper Award by Elsevier's publication UK in 2013. He follow instructions of engineers. Dr. Sharma has been ICR for drafting syllabus for M.Tech and PhD program in food processing engineering being offered by State Agriculture University. He currently member of a research advisory committee of ICR for Central Institute of Engineering Bhopal. The prestigious research institute ICR in an area of agriculture engineering. Okay, this only the introduction of G.P. Sharma.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Kailash ji.
Thank you, sir. I would like to call our respected Dean, sir, for sharing his thoughts on his special day. Respected Dean, sir.
Thank you, Dr. Kailash. It's our pleasure to welcome Professor G.P. Sharma, sir, on today's webinar. Sir, before starting the webinar, I want to give some information about our esteemed Parul University. Our Parul University is leading in the domain of the education under the dynamic leadership of Honorable President Sir Dr. Devanshu Patel Sir, Honorable Provost Sir Professor Dr. Emil Patel Sir, Honorable Registrar Sir Professor Dr. H. L. Vijay Kumar Sir. Sir, in the Faculty of Agriculture, we are offering the degrees in the B.Tech Agriculture Engineering, B.Tech Dairy Technology, B.Sc. Agriculture, and recently we have started the Diploma in Animal Husbandry. So, if you see, we are catering the need of the society by providing the education in such a domain. We are having sufficient land for the experimentation at farm. We are having well-equipped laboratories for the students. We have very good faculty members in the different domain, and they take care of the students. Professor Sharma is having a good exposure in the field of the food science and engineering. He is very much dynamic by the way of the teaching learning and the research. Today's topic is very much relevant as per the scenario whenever we are having the use food loss before preserving them. So how these can be preserved by the different ways, how the microwaves can play the significant role for the food processing. The today's topic will be dealt by the eminent scientist, I would say, Professor Sharma. So with these words, I would like to welcome Professor Sharma on this virtual platform with esteemed Parul University for his webinar. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you, Sharma sir and Kailash ji. I really am thankful that you have given me this opportunity to deliberate on the topic of my interest and to interact with the students and the faculty of your university, which is pioneer in the field of education, imparting education in agriculture, various sectors of agriculture. So can we start, sir? If you
Yes, sure.
I would like to hand over mic to our special person, Dr. G.P. Sharma, sir, and please start to our lecture. Thank you, sir.
Niche. Hmm? I think it's visible now. You are able to see my slide?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
Now it is visible.
Okay, sir. I shall today be speaking on the application of microwaves in food processing with the special emphasis on the dehydration process because this is one of the operations where a lot of energy is required, and I can say that this is an operation which is energy intensive.
Sir, Marshall, now, can you go for the slideshow?
Okay. Kushal? स्लाइडशो का कह रहे हैं क्या से? हाँ सर, स्लाइड दिख रहा है ना आपको?
स्लाइड इज विजिबल बट गो फॉर द स्लाइड शो ऑप्शन सो द स्लाइड विल बी एनलार्ज्ड.
स्लाइड शो
एट द बॉटम. एट द बॉटम या नाउ नाउ इट इज आउट. F5 can be used for slide show.
Is it true? Is it okay, sir?
Sir, it is visible. Yeah, now it is okay. Now it is okay, sir.
Okay.
Please carry on.
Yes.
Okay.
So I shall today be speaking about the application of microwaves in the dehydration process of food. Now, dehydration is one of the unit operations which is invariably carried out on all the food materials in order to improve its shelf life, to increase its keeping period, rather. Now, India, as we know, is the largest producer of fruits and vegetables. We are producing about 118 million tons of vegetables and 53 million tons of fruits. And that means we are producing a large amount of fruits and vegetables, but about 30 to 40% of the produce is wasted, is we lose it due to poor infrastructure for its storage, process capacity, and because there is an absence of the cold chain. Now, this 40% of loss, it amounts to approximately 99 crores of rupees, which is a huge loss to us. And this loss can be minimized simply by putting more efforts in the processing of fruits and vegetables. Now, if you look at the behavior of the food, the vegetable foods, once they crop, they continue to respire, and therefore this respiration process brings about the production of ethylene gas, and that softens the tissues and matures the fruits and vegetables. Animal food behaves differently. It starts to decompose, and the typical metabolic rate in this case of animal food is quite high, is about 1 watt per kg. Now, foods, they are classified into two categories broadly, the perishable and non-perishable foods. According to the FDA, that is Food and Drug Administration, It defines the perishable as perishable foods that is subject to decay, spoilage, or bacteria unless it is properly refrigerated or frozen. The definition of non-perishable food items shall be any food item made for human consumption that does not require further processing to be considered inedible, nor require special handling to remain edible after purchase, like the canned foods. Now, what spoils the food? The decomposition is set in by attack, that is the external cause due to the growth of microorganisms that secrete enzyme and produce bad smell. Now, microbes, they can be bacteria, can be fungi, can be mold also. Then another factor is the biological evolution. That means the internal cause is the enzyme that are present in the fruits and vegetables. And these enzymes, they work on the fruits and vegetables, that is the substrate we call, and they develop rancidity or bring about qualitative deterioration in the fruits and vegetables. Like the lipase is the enzyme which is present in the milk. So when this lipase comes in contact with the fat, it works on it and produces the fishy flavor, that is the rancidity is developed. So this is a good example of the biological evolution. Chemical attack is another way, that is the oxidation by atmospheric air, and this brings about certain changes in the quality, in the color also. Moisture that is present in the food material plays a very important role. Though the moisture is there, as it provides, naturally, because it provides a typical texture to the fruits and vegetables. But its presence also is also deleterious because it creates an environment where microbes can grow, and it provides mobility to the food molecules, and the fruits and vegetables, they are prone to microbial attack because of the presence of the moisture. Another factor is the pH of the food. The temperature of the environment is equally important in the spoilage process. The lower temperature will reduce the spoilage process because the respiration rate is reduced, and other biological reactions which are responsible for the spoilage, that those reactions are slowed down. So how the food is spoiled? When the moisture or the temperature conditions are favorable for the growth of microorganisms, they multiply and grow and cause foodborne illness by producing toxins. They also break down foods, producing unpleasant changes in taste, texture, and appearance, changes that we recognize as spoilage. Now, as I told you, that moisture is an integral part of all of our fruits and vegetables, all of our foods rather. It is present naturally. Now, foods based on the quantity of moisture present in them, they are classified into three categories: low moisture foods, intermediate moisture foods, and high moisture foods. High moisture foods will have the moisture greater than 20%, and this is the category which is prone to spoilage. Low moisture foods, they can be kept safely for longer period of time. Jaisa pulses hain, spices hain, where the moisture, or apne cereals hain, where the moisture content is reduced considerably at the time of harvest and even after that also. So lower is the moisture content, the shelf life is better. Medium and high moisture foods, as I told you, they are very susceptible to the microbial spoilage and they need adequate processing and preservation prior to their packaging. Now, there are different, the moisture that is present in the food material is classified into different categories, like tightly bound water, where the water molecules is tightly bound to, or it interacts with the functional group of the solutes. For example, the protein and the fat, sorry, not the fat, the protein and the carbohydrates, these are the molecules, carbonyl and carboxyl groups. These are the active sites which interact with the water molecules, and the water molecules, they get attached to these specific sites or active sites. Second category is the loosely bound water, where the water interacts with the functional groups, but not as strongly as is done in tightly bound water. And the third category is the free water. Most of the food materials would have this category. The free water is not bound, and therefore it acts as a bulk water. It is available for the microbial growth, enzymatic reactions, and other chemical reactions. Now, so one thing is clear, that all of our fruits and vegetables, they have plentiful of moisture, and this moisture, though, provides a typical texture and taste, but is equally deleterious so far as the shelf life of the food material is concerned. So in case we intend to improve the keeping quality or improve the shelf life, the moisture content has to be eliminated, has to be reduced to an extent that makes our food system stable. Stable means that the food material is not attacked by the microbes easily, though it will interact with the atmosphere, but the microbes will not be allowed to grow. So this process of removing the moisture content from the food material, we term this as drying. The commercial food dehydration eventually evolved within a scientific-based environment and made possible the establishment of a worldwide industry capable of providing a convenient and nutritious dry food products. Now, what is drying? As I told you, explained to you earlier, the term drying is reserved for the process that accomplished the removal of water from a wet solid by evaporation. So that means if we want to remove the moisture from the food system, we have to apply some kind of energy. We have to supply energy to the system to expel the water, to remove the water from the food. And that removal is through a process of evaporation. Now, this is an important aspect related to food dehydration. We call it the moisture sorption isotherm, because the food material, when kept in an environment, open in an environment, it starts interacting with it. Now, depending upon the amount of water present in the food material initially, it may lose the water or it may absorb the moisture from the environment. So it depends upon the, basically, it depends on the partial pressure of water vapor that is present in the, of the food material compared to that of the environment at given temperature. So this study, moisture sorption isotherm, is very much important so far as the keeping quality or the shelf life studies are concerned. I'll not go into the details of it, but this is really a very important aspect when it comes to removing the water from the food material, or to improve its shelf life, or to select a suitable packaging material for a given food material. Now, for doing this, what we have to know is that how the moisture content of the food material is varying with the relative humidity of the environment. Because if the relative humidity of the environment is higher, the most likely condition would be that the food material will absorb the moisture from the environment, and vice versa. Now, it is pertinent to mention here that the two processes, the adsorption and the desorption, that is when the water is removed or liberated from the surface or is adsorbed at the surface, these two processes follow the different path at given temperature and given atmospheric condition. So what is important here is the relative humidity of the air and the temperature of the environment, which affect the shelf life of the food material. Now, this kind of behavior of the food to absorb or dissolve the moisture is studied by considering a number of saturated salt solution, which at their saturation state at a given temperature will create an environment of a fixed relative humidity. For example, if I take a saturated salt solution of KOH, this salt solution at saturation state at 30 degree centigrade would create an relative humidity of 7.38%. At 40 degree centigrade, the same saturation solution will create a relative humidity of 6.26%. So we make use of the different salt saturation saturated salt solution, which will create the environment of a fixed relative humidity around the food sample. Now, how this study is performed? The most most commonly conventional way is the static method, where we take a desiccator, we put a small sample inside the desiccator and the saturated salt solution beneath it. The entire system is then maintained at a constant temperature, and we keep measuring the change in the weight of food sample continuously. Now, when there is no change, further change in the weight of the sample, at this is the state where the food sample is in equilibrium with the immediate environment, and the moisture content of the food is very much important to us at this state, and we call it the equilibrium moisture content. And the relative humidity of the environment here is the equilibrium relative humidity. I'll go back to make things clear. So this is the equilibrium moisture content, and this is the relative humidity, which we keep changing by changing the saturated salt solution at a given temperature. So if the food material is absorbing the moisture, we'll get this curve, and if it is desorbing, we'll get this curve. Now, why this study is important? Because as a food processor, when we talk of dehydration, and as I told you that the dehydration process is a very energy intensive process, so we should know that a given food material has to be dried to a particular moisture content so that it is stable. Now, what is that final moksha content? How to arrive to that value? So, in that, to arrive to that value, this kind of study is very much important. And we do it also. Which is varying from 0 to 1, is a parameter that indicates us the state of water. That means how active is the water present in the food. So if the water is more active, the microbial attack is more easily possible here. Now this water activity is expressed in terms of as a decimal fraction, and as decimal fraction of the equilibrium relative humidity of a particular material. That is, if the water activity is 0.6, that means the ERH is 60%. Equilibrium relative humidity is 60%. Now I'll go about to speak about the drying fundamentals. Drying is a process in which the latent heat of vaporization is supplied to the liquid water present in the food, and the resulting vapor is removed from the food material. Now, as I had told you that the food material have plenty of water, and if you want to remove this water partially or fully, we have to supply some energy. Now, that amount of energy would depend upon the amount of water that is to be removed. And the energy is supplied as partly as the sensible heat and largely as the latent heat to change the state of water from liquid into the vapor. Now, this dehydration or drying, it is a simultaneous heat and moisture transport process where the heat is applied and simultaneously the water is also removed. The drying process can be subdivided into two processes occurring simultaneously, as the transfer of energy, that is heat, from the surrounding atmosphere to evaporate the surface moisture, characterized as active drying. The removal of water as vapor from material surface depends on the external conditions of temperature, air humidity, and flow area of surface exposed and the pressure. The transfer of internal moisture to the surface of the solid and its subsequent evaporation according to process, it is named restrictive or resistive drying. The movement of moisture internally within the solid is a function of physical nature of the solid, the temperature and its moisture content. Okay, I'll explain it here. See, these are the particulates. We have a food system here, and this food is comprising of very small particles. Now, within these particles, there is a gap we call the intraparticle gap. Now, this gap, this space forms a continuous channel, which we call the capillaries. So, this capillary basically is the space where the water is residing. And when the drying is done, the water moves from interior to the surface, because the water is removed from the surface first, and as the water is removed from the surface, the water from the layers beneath moves up and comes to the surface. So this is how the drying process is continuously occurring, and when this is happening, the water molecules, they pass through these capillaries, which is formed within the food matrix. Now, water within the food will either be bound or unbound so to the solids, and this will influence the drying process and its stability. The bound water, the water held in loose chemical combination, present as a liquid solution within the solid or even trapped in the microstructure of the solid, and exerts a vapor pressure less than that of the pure water. Unbound water is the moisture in excess of bound water or bound moisture, and its presence influences the equilibrium moisture content and therefore the water activity. The factors which are affecting the drying process are air temperature, air velocity, relative humidity of the air, and the product characteristics. Where if you are increasing the air temperature, the drying becomes faster. With increase in the air velocity, the drying becomes faster, but the air velocity will not have an appreciable effect beyond a certain threshold value, that is 3 meters per second. If we exceed the air velocity beyond 3 meters per second, the drying rates or the drying time is not appreciably reduced. Rather, it will be increasing our energy loss or energy consumption. Relative humidity of the air is, of course, something difficult to control, but influences the drying process. If the relative humidity of the air is low, the drying becomes faster. And the product characteristics, if it is porous, if the food material that we are drying is porous or hygroscopic, so that product characteristics influences the drying process accordingly. Now the dryers, they are classified into two, the batch type and the continuous type. The batch type dryers or the continuous dryers, they are further classified into three categories depending upon the way heat is being transmitted, that is radiation, conduction and convection. And this heating can be done under subatmospheric condition and also atmospheric condition. Now in food industries, mostly the drying is accomplished by or in a tray dryer. The most conventional method being practiced is the use of tray dryer, though there are other kind of dryers also which are being employed depending upon the kind of material to be dried. Like if we have a semi-solid or liquid food materials to be dried, we use a spray dryer. If we have the particulate to be dried, we have fluidized bed dryer. And for fruits and vegetables, mostly the tray dryer is used. The tray dryers, they are small in scale and usually they are used as pilot plants. The operation of these dryers is periodical and moist product is subjected to unsteady state process. The dryer allows processing of different products from liquid slurries to solid piece form materials. Now, such dryers are either used as such or in groups with an output of fresh material up to 20 tons per day. A good control of drying condition is possible here. The material is placed in relatively thin layers, that is, the thickness of the layer in trays is ranging between 1 to 6 centimeters. So we call it thin layer drying. And this thin layer drying results in more uniform heating of the product, drying of product. So the qualitative changes within the dryer will be less varying. The main disadvantage of this type of dryer is the large amount of manwork involved in operating them. And because of their versatility, they are relatively widespread in food industry. Now these are the different types of dryers, like tray dryer, tunnel dryer, rotary dryer, spray dryer, and they are being used for different type of food materials. As I told you, that fruits and vegetables, mostly the tray dryers are used, milk, coffee, tea, juice, spray dryers, then drum dryers, they are also used for milk and soaps, and freeze dryers. The freezing is a little expensive, but mostly the juices, when they are converted into powder, the freeze drying process is followed. The freeze dryer is used here. Now, I'll now switch over to this microwave application in the drying process. Now, as I told you that the drying is a energy intensive operation, and this is energy intensive because when the heat is applied to the food material in a conventional way, the surface of the food material dries out first, and it reduces the thermal conductivity at the surface of the food material, and therefore the further transfer of energy from air into the food material reduces considerably, and therefore the process becomes slower. Now this is not the case when microwaves are applied in food processing. There are different ways in which these microwaves are currently being used. So far as the food processing is concerned, it is being used in the drying, tempering, pasteurization and sterilization of milk and juices, in blanching, in baking also. So, but I will restrict myself to the drying operation here. Now, microwaves, they are electromagnetic waves. And if we see this spectrum, depending upon their frequency or the wavelength, they have different kind of uses. Like microwaves, they are used in the aircraft also for communication purpose. Then we have the microwaves, they are used in TV, our television also, radars also, and in X-ray also. So it has a vast use, and its application basically in a particular domain depends on its frequency or the wavelength. Now, so far as the food processing is concerned, the microwaves frequency between 300 megahertz to 300 gigahertz is employed, where the corresponding wavelength is 1 meter to 1 millimeter. Now, in food processing, basically two frequencies are recommended. One is 915 megahertz, another is 2.45 gigahertz, that is 2450 megahertz. These are the two frequency bands recommended for use in food processing industry. So most of the microwave generators that we use nowadays are the generators which produce microwaves at this frequency, 2450 megahertz. Now, what are microwaves? Now, microwaves, they are electromagnetic waves which have electrical and the magnetic fields. Now, these two, electrical field and the magnetic field, they are transfers to each other. Now, food materials which are non-magnetic in nature, so it is this component of the microwave, that is the electrical field, which is interacting with the food material so far as its heating is concerned, not this part. The magnetic part will be useful for the ferrous material which are magnetic in nature. Now, so far as the behavior of microwaves is concerned, it is absorbed very easily by the foods, oils, and water. It is very easily transmitted through glass and plastics and the microwave waves. But the microwaves are reflected back. They cannot pass through the metals, applicators, and the waveguides. I'll come to those things also, what is waveguide and what is applicator. But this is certain that the metallic surface will reflect the microwaves, will not allow the microwaves to pass through it, whereas the glass and plastics, the microwaves can very easily pass through. Now, when we considered the processing of food materials using microwaves as a heating medium, as a heating source, the dielectric properties are very much important, because they are a link between the electromagnetic waves and the material being heated. And it gives better understanding of the internal heating mechanism to optimize the process controls, such as power level, food mass, and what should be its thickness. Now here, what is important here is that what should be the power that we should apply on a given food material to process it. Second is how much food mass should be taken in a batch for processing purpose. And third aspect is what should be its thickness. They are all interrelated so far as a process is concerned, processing of a given food material is concerned. And the dielectric properties here play a very important role in deciding or in helping us in deciding the power level, the quantity of the food to be processed in a batch, and the thickness of the food material that should be kept. Now, these dielectric properties means we are concerned with two properties, that is the dielectric constant and the loss factor. These are the two important characteristics of all food materials. The dielectric constant, which is the ability of the material to store microwave energy. So if the dielectric constant is more, that means the food material has good ability to store more amount of microwave energy into them. The second property is the dielectric loss factor, which means its ability to convert the stored energy into heat. So if the loss factor is more, then more amount of stored microwave energy is converted into heat. So the food material is heating at a faster rate. And using these two properties, the dielectric constant and the loss factor, we can estimate the dissipation factor, that is the loss tension. It is the ratio of the dielectric constant to the dielectric loss factor. There are different methods by which the dielectric properties can be estimated: the resonant cavity method, transmission line method, and coaxial line method. It depends, basically, the choice will depend upon the type of food material that we are going to handle. Now, the first is resonance cavity method. Now, this is the resonance cavity that is employed. The food material is kept inside this cavity, and we pass the microwaves at a given frequency through the resonance cavity. Now, this is the setup that I have used for measurement of dielectric properties. You see that this is the guide. This is the resonant cavity. And in this method, we calculate the resonant frequency And we also calculate the quality factor of the cavity. And then we find out the dielectric constant and the dielectric loss factor. Now, from these two dielectric properties, that dielectric characteristics, we calculate the penetration depth. Penetration depth is the depth from the surface of the food material to which the microwaves will penetrate. The microwaves of given frequency will penetrate. So for the frequency that we use is 2450 megahertz. The wavelength of this microwave frequency is about 12.23 centimeters. And the penetration depth would be calculated based on the dielectric constant and loss factor. And if it comes to the thickness that the food material should have, it is nearly double the penetration depth. That is, the thickness of the food material should be nearly two times the penetration depth that we compute from this expression. Now, the penetration depth obviously depends upon the frequency. We have, say, the microwaves where the wavelength is less is more, the penetration depth is more. Here the wavelength is small, the penetration depth is small. So the infrared have very poor penetration as compared to microwaves. So that is the reason that when large amount of food material is to be processed, we make use of microwaves. And if only surface heating is required, we go for the infrared radiations. These are the typical values of dielectric constant and loss factor for different food components. Now, the question is, how do microwaves heat the food? It's a very interesting phenomena. Heating is accomplished by absorption of microwave energy by the water molecules. The water molecules, they are bipolar in nature. It has got the oxygen and hydrogen molecules. One is positive, another is negative. So when the polarity of the microwaves is changing, because it has a frequency of about 2450 times, it will be changing its per second, it will be changing its polarity. So every time the polarity is changed, the water molecules, which is bipolar in nature, it tries to align with the changing polarity of microwaves, and a lot of friction is generated, and this results into generation of heat. So one is the absorption of microwave energy by the water molecule, that heating is accomplished. Another is the ionic conduction, that there are a lot of ions in the food materials, they get heated up and they conduct the heat through the food material. But compared to this, the ionic conduction is a very small proportion, is a very small proportion. So this is what I told you. This is a water molecule. Here the oxygen, which is a negative charged particle, and this is hydrogen is positive. So this is a dipole molecule or bipole molecule, water molecule. So these microwaves, which are changing their orientation billion times per second, would make the water molecule to orient itself billion times in 1 second. So that creates a lot of frictional energy. Now, this is another way of showing it. The electromagnetic energy converts into rotational kinetic energy and into horizontal kinetic energy of molecules, and the average kinetic energy of molecule is thermal energy, therefore. Now, if I compare the microwave heating or drying to the conventional drying process where hot air is used as a heating medium, the two process heating process are different. In the microwave heating, the heat energy is translocated to the interior of the food material, and heat moves from interior to the outside surface. Now, this is not the case in conventional heating. In the conventional heating, the heat is deposited or is absorbed at the surface of the food material, and from surface it conducts into the food material, deeper into the food material. So fundamentally, the heat is flowing from outside to inside in case of conventional heating. In case of microwave heating, the heat is moving from inside to outside surface. So this is the fundamental difference between the two heating methods, the convection heating and microwave heating. Now, all microwave processing equipment will have a microwave generator, and where the we call it the magnetron, where the microwaves of given frequency is generated, and this is the magnetron where it is the microwaves are generated, and then it is conducted to the cavity where it interacts with the food material that is kept in the cavity. This is the cavity, and we have a fan here, so this will reflect the microwaves in a zigzag pattern, in uneven pattern, so that a set pattern is not formed inside the cavity. Now, this is a typical magnetron that our household microwave oven has got these days. Some 20 years back, the cost of the magnetron would be in some lakhs of rupees, but today we can purchase this in thousands of rupees, maybe 4,000-5,000 rupees we can purchase this magnetron. They have become very cheaper in cost, and therefore they find a lot of now use in food processing. I mean, it is feasible now to put them in use in our microwave based equipments, processing equipments. Now, these are the waveguides. These are the metallic structures, and the function of these waveguides is to transmit the microwaves from the point of generation to the point of application, that is from magnetron to into the cavity. So the microwaves, these waveguides will carry the microwaves from magnetron where they are generated and deliver those microwaves into the cavity. Advantages of microwave heating: the shorter processing time for heating and drying compared to the conventional method. It is observed that the processing time is considerably less. Suppose it takes about 6 to 7 hours in hot air drying or convective drying, the same amount of food material can be dried within an hour if we are using microwaves as the heating medium. Then because it is resulting into the volumetric heating, so the drying time is reduced and the heating is comparatively more uniform. less energy is required. This is another advantage. Greater controllability, we can control the temperature of the food material and the shorter production line lengths, because the drying rates are faster, so the residence time of the food material in the processing line is reduced considerably. Now this is a typical laboratory scale microwave unit which has got a blower, the electrical heater for conventional drying purpose, and then we have the microwave generator which will divert the microwaves into the drying chamber. So it is the use of the convective drying in conjunction with the microwaves. Now what is important here is when we are using microwaves for food processing, the leakage from the unit should not exceed the limit threshold value, which is 0.1 watt per square meter. And it is always advisable to stay away from the unit at a distance of about 1.5 meter when the unit is in operation, so that we do not expose ourselves to the leaking microwaves. Now I'll just explain the work that we have done here. What we did is that we modified the microwave oven into a convective microwave dryer, and we did a small scale experiment in the laboratory. We developed a continuous weighing system so that we need not to take out the sample every time for weighing purpose. The oven was modified in the sense that we can supply hot air into the chamber and we can apply the microwaves in conjunction with hot air to dry the food material. The air temperatures that we chose were 40, 50, 60 and 70 degrees centigrade. The power level that we chose, that we selected, were 10, 20, 30 and 40 watts. The microwaves, they were applied continuously, not in impulse or in pulsed mode. The microwaves were applied continuously in the drying process, and the air velocity was kept as 1 or 2 meters per second. The two levels were selected. Now, this is our finding, that when no microwave were applied, only the hot air was used as a heating medium at 70 degrees centigrade. At air velocity of 1 meter per second, the drying time was 7.5 hours for a given sample of food material, that is about 100 grams. Now see, the moment we applied microwave power, we use microwaves, along with the hot air, the drying time reduced from 7.5 hours to 2.16. An increase in the microwave power further at a given air temperature reduced the drying time considerably. This happened at other velocity also. We also calculated the energy consumption in the entire process. So in the convective drying, in hot air drying process, at a velocity of 1 meter per second, the energy consumption was 85 megajoules per kg of water evaporated, and it gradually reduced with application or with the use of microwaves along with convective drying. That is, when the convective drying was done in conjunction with the microwaves, the energy consumption reduced dramatically. Now we used the garlic cloves as a sample, as a food material. Now this is the raw peeled clove, and this 5 is the rehydrated microwaves हमने जो dry किया था उसको जब हमने rehydrate किया तो this was very light in color and this encouraged us to apply this concept on further on pilot scale basis. So we thought of developing a pilot scale microwave drying unit for the agro processing units. Several units are functional in and around the state of Gujarat and Rajasthan, dehydrating garlic and onions as primary product for export purpose. Most of these units have been operating somewhat successfully, but on low returns due to the fact that their cost of production is much higher. The Indian industries for dehydration of vegetables and fruits can survive in the present scenario only on the strength of product quality and cost competitiveness, which can possibly be achieved through technology upgradation in the manufacturing process, apart from getting the raw material of superior quality through contract farming. Microwave drying is a promising solution as it results into shorter drying time and thus improves the quality of the dry product. Lot of work has been done in respect of applying microwaves for drying a variety of foods and established that technologically this idea is feasible. Most of the reported technology on microwave related combination drying are based on laboratory scale system using 2450 megahertz microwave ovens as main microwave source. So there is a need for further studies to bridge the gap between the laboratory research and the industrial application. So we diverted our present work, which was aimed at developing a batch type microwave dryer usable by small scale garlic processing units and to study the quality aspect of the finished product. Sir, this is the batch type of microwave dryer that we have developed in our department. The capacity, this dimension of the microwave cavity is some 70 centimeter by 70 centimeter by 55 centimeter. So this is the cavity where the food material will be kept and will be processed. Thickness of the cavity, that is, this is made from the stainless steel with mirror finish surface. Stainless steel sheet that we used is of 16 gauge, and we used S304 with mirror finish. The surface had a mirror finishing. We used the magnetron of 1.5 kilowatt, and this magnetron can be operated in the duty cycle between 10 to 100%, as we do have in our domestic microwave oven also. And we can also apply this, the dryer had a provision to apply this in continuous mode also. The frequency, obviously the magnetron had this 2450 megahertz frequency of the microwaves, and its efficiency was about 60 to 70%. And for cooling the magnetron, because it is operating continuously, an air blower was also provided for cooling the magnetron. The bottom of the sample holder, sorry, this is the sample holder where we kept our food material to be dried. The bottom of the sample holder as well as its rim must have perforations of about 1.5 to 2 millimeter diameter. That is about 6 to 8 perforations per square inch to allow the evaporated water vapors to escape from the drying sample, thereby preventing condensation of the water vapor into the sample. So when the heating is being done, the vapors are generated as the water evaporates from interior of the food material and comes into the atmosphere. Now this air, moisture-laden air, needs to be evacuated continuously so as to not to permit the condensation of the water vapor back on the surface of the sample. Yeah, isme agar hoga kya, I'll explain here. Ki if we are keeping our sample here, the, as I told you, the heating is volumetric heating. So the product temperature will rise very fast, whereas the surrounding air will not be heated up, will not get heated up. So when the moisture comes out into the air, which is at very low temperature, so there is a possibility that these water vapors, when coming into the air outside, will condense back on the surface of the food material because air being at low temperature. So this air which is surrounding the food material needs to be evacuated continuously. Product holder, this is the product holder, a circular type product holder having diameter of 60 centimeter and the height of the rim we kept was 12 centimeter. The sample holder was made from the Teflon, which is a material compatible to microwave field. Now we had this is a turntable rotating, which can be rotated at 360 degree while traveling through the microwave field for even distribution of energy. See, what happens is when the microwave energy are taken into the cavity, they strike the metallic surface and bounce back. So in this process, they form a fixed pattern of their travel. So this generates certain hot and cold points. So what can happen is that a product, when the product is not stable, then the part of the product which is at hot point will get heated up very quickly. Its temperature will rise very rapidly, whereas this may not happen at other places, where at other places of the product lying on cold points or lying around the cold points. So this will result into uneven heating of the food material. So to avoid this, the food material is continuously rotated in the cavity, so that the food material is exposed to cold and hot points continuously. So the uniform heating is achieved. The mode of the industrial this that we made was continuous, and it also is step up of 0.15 kilowatt variation. A provision was also made for inlet and outlet of the air into and from the microwave cavity. The exhaust fan or the air blower must give an air velocity of about 1 meter per second. So this is the blower which we put on the side of the dryer, which continuously evacuated the moisture laden air from the cavity. This is the control for controlling the microwave power inside the cavity. Now this is the dryer, and we dehydrated the garlic cloves. We kept this material in the sample holder, and we dried it in the dryer. A batch of about 7.5 kg of peeled garlic cloves were charged in the dryer. The initial moisture content of the garlic clove was about 2.03 gram of water per gram of dry matter, and we dried this to a final moisture content of 0.06. This is the recommended standard. So this was the final moisture content in the finally dried product, 0.06 gram water per gram dry matter. The drying took about 6.25 hours. This is the dried garlic cloves, which are little brown in now color. The quality of the product was measured in terms of color and also in terms of the flavor strength, because allicin is the component which is responsible for or gives or imparts the typical pungent flavor to the garlic. So the flavor strength was determined by the standard chloramine T method, and the Hunter Lab color meter was used for measuring the color on LAB scale. Now, I'm happy to say that when these qualities were compared to the commercial sample, the product that we dried using microwaves was much lighter in color compared to the commercial sample that we procured from the market. The flavor strength was higher than that available with the commercial sample. So the quality was also good. The quality of the dried garlic cloves was superior. We made powder out of it, and it was readily accepted by the household. हमने काफी घरों में उसको supply किया और we took their feedback also. So काफी अच्छा उनका feedback रहा. We also dried the turmeric with this dryer and converted it into the turmeric powder. We also dried ginger and made ginger powder. We also dried onion slices, white onion especially, and they had very good quality. The limitation of the microwave drying is that the first is the high capital cost. The initial investment required for the equipment is very high, but the process pays it back by virtue of its low operating cost and increased output. More complex technology device, it requires a skilled person for repair and its operation. And the microwave radiation problem is one aspect. By proper shielding, the radiations can be brought down to safer limits. We could conclude that it is feasible, technically feasible, to dry out fruits and vegetables using microwaves in conjunction with the hot air drying. And the microwave dried product, they are of superior quality as compared to commercially available product dried by using hot air. So thank you. This is my...
Thank you, sir. Thank you for your valuable share with our webinar. And this is a matter for a pride from me. I am proposing vote of thanks for this webinar. I am very thankful for Chairman Dr. C.K. Sharma sir, principal and dean, for support and moral value. And very special thanks to Dr. G.P. Sharma.
Yeah, any question I can take?
Sure. To glance this webinar. I would like to thanks for teaching and non-teaching staff for their support and coordinations well for me. And special thanks to our students for active participation with those warm words and a kind to message. We move to the end of today's webinar. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Hello, Professor Sharma.
Sir.
Sir, I have a small query.
Yes, sir.
On behalf of my students, and
yes,
being the student of the biological science, I can say, and agriculture sciences both, whenever we are applying the microwaves for preserving the food material, how it impacts at the molecular level regarding the nutritional value.
सर इसमें यह है कि बेसिकली जो हमारे जो व्हेन हम जब जब हम प्रोसेसिंग करते हैं तो जो माइक्रोवेव्स हैं ये वाटर मॉलिक्यूल्स के साथ इंटरेक्ट करते हैं.
एब्सोल्युटली.
तो आप आपका क्वेश्चन मुझे क्लियर नहीं हुआ. न्यूट्रिशनल मींस विटामिन्स एंड अदर थिंग्स.
Vitamins, minerals, protein content, amino acids, etc., etc. How it impacts such molecules, or more specifically, biomolecules?
नहीं जो
is there any
नहीं सर ऐसा कोई deleterious effect quality wise नहीं पाया गया है अभी तक. Except कि fats से जरूर है थोड़ा सा अगर ज़्यादा high fat या oil या घी उस केस में ऐसा पाया कि थोड़ा सा ट्रांस फैटी एसिड्स जनरेट हो जाते हैं अगर ज्यादा से ज्यादा. बट अभी तक ऐसा कोई एडवर्स इफेक्ट और किसी कंपोनेंट पे तो नहीं पाया गया है. और मेरे ख्याल से मैं कुछ अभी जर्नल में पढ़ रहा था कुछ महीने पहले यूएसए में तो इन्होंने पैस्चराइजेशन और स्टरलाइजेशन मिल्क का माइक्रोवेव्स के द्वारा करना शुरू किया है. दे हैव डेवलप्ड द यूनिट्स. वेरी नाइस वेरी नाइस.
बिकॉज देयर आर सम रिपोर्ट्स रिगार्डिंग द कन्वर्जन ऑफ द फैट इनटू द ट्रांस फैट. सो आई थॉट इट इज इंपैक्टिंग अदर्स आर नॉट. इट कम्स इनटू द माइंड व्हेनेवर वी आर यूजिंग द माइक्रोवेव्स.
यस यस आई फुली एग्री. लेकिन अभी ऐसा कोई I have not come across any such literature which says the effect on protein molecules or vitamins or minerals. Fat ke upar zarur kuch reports hain available jahan fat trans fats fatty acids mein convert ho raha hai longer exposure ke liye.
Thank you very much.
Right sir. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you sir. Thank you with connecting sir,
I'm grateful to Sharma sir for giving me this opportunity to present my work to the students, and I'm hopeful that this might have benefited them, their knowledge, what is going on in our university, and what work we have done in the area of application of microwave in the dehydration of food material. We did this work with financial assistance from Khadi and Village Industries Commission, Bombay. We developed this dryer for them, and we transferred this technology to them at their Wardha center. Thank you, sir.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
Namaskar.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. Okay, sir. Thank you.